Now, folks, here's something else I got a problem with. The Ten Commandments. Here's my problem. Why are there ten? You don't need ten. I think the list of commandments was deliberately and artificially inflated to get it up to ten. It's a padded list. Here's what they did. About 5,000 years ago, a bunch of religious and political hustlers got together to try to figure out how to control people, how to keep them in line. They knew people were basically stupid and would believe anything they were told, so they announced that God had given them some commandments. Up on a mountain, when no one was around, God had given them the Ten Commandments. But let me ask you this. When they were sitting around making this shit up, why did they pick ten? Why ten? Why not nine or 11? I'll tell you why. Because ten sounds official. Ten sounds important. They knew if it was 11, people wouldn't take it seriously. So what, are you kidding me? The 11 commandments? Get the fuck out of here. But ten. Ten sounds important. Ten is the basis for the decimal system. It's a decade. It's a psychologically satisfying number. The top ten, the ten most wanted, the ten best dressed. So having ten commandments was really a marketing decision. And to me, it's clearly a bullshit list. It's a political document artificially inflated to sell better. I'm going to show you how you could reduce the number of commandments and come up with a list that's a little more workable and logical. We're going to start with the first three, and I'll use the Roman Catholic version because those are the ones I was taught as a little boy. I am the Lord thy God. Thou shalt not have strange gods before me. Thou shalt not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain. Thou shalt keep holy the Sabbath. Right off the bat, the first three, pure bullshit. Sabbath day, Lord's name, strange gods. Spooky language. Spooky language. Designed to scare and control primitive people. In no way does superstitious nonsense like this apply to the lives of intelligent, civilized humans in the 21st century. You throw out the first three commandments, whoosh, you're down to seven. Next, honor thy father and mother. Obedience, respect for authority. Just another name for controlling people. The truth is, obedience and respect should not be automatic. They should be earned. They should be based on the parents' performance. Parents' performance. All right? Some parents deserve respect. Most of them don't. Period. You're down to six. Now, in the interest of logic, something religion is very uncomfortable with, we're going to jump around the list a little bit. Thou shalt not steal, thou shalt not bear false witness. Stealing and lying. Well, actually, these two both prohibit the same kind of behavior. Dishonesty, stealing, and lying. So you don't need two of them. Instead, you combine them and you call it thou shalt not be dishonest. And suddenly, you're down to five. And as long as we're combining, I have two others that belong together. Thou shalt not commit adultery. Thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's wife. Once again, these two prohibit the same kind of behavior. In this case, marital infidelity. The difference is coveting takes place in the mind. And I don't think you should outlaw fantasizing about someone else's wife. Otherwise, what's a guy going to think about when he's waxing his carrot? But marital fidelity is a good idea, so we're going to keep the idea and call this one, thou shalt not be unfaithful. And suddenly, we're down to four. But when you think about it, honesty and fidelity are really part of the same overall value. So in truth, you could combine the two honesty commandments with the two fidelity commandments and give them simpler language, positive language instead of negative, and call the whole thing, thou shalt always be honest and faithful, and we're down to three. Thou shalt, they're going away fast. Thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's goods. This one is just plain fucking stupid. Coveting your neighbor's goods is what keeps the economy going. And all right? Your neighbor gets a vibrator that plays O Come All Ye Faithful. You want to get one too. Coveting creates jobs. Leave it alone. You throw out coveting and you're down to two now, the big honesty and fidelity commandment, and the one we haven't talked about yet, thou shalt not kill, murder, the fifth commandment. But when you think about it, When you think about it, religion has never really had a big problem with murder. Not really. More people have been killed in the name of God than for any other reason. All you have to do... Shit. All you have to do is look at Northern Ireland, the Middle East, Kashmir, the Inquisition, the Crusades, and the World Trade Center to see how seriously the religious folks take thou shalt not kill. The more devout they are, the more they see murder as being negotiable. It's negotiable. You know? It depends. It depends. It depends on who's doing the killing and who's getting killed. So, with all of this in mind, I leave you with my revised list of the two commandments. Thou shalt always be honest and faithful to the provider of thy nookie. And thou shalt try real hard not to kill anyone, unless, of course, they pray to a different invisible man from the one you pray to. Two is all you need. Moses could have carried him down the hill in his fucking pocket. And if they had a list like that, I wouldn't mind those folks in Alabama putting it up on the courthouse wall. As long as they included one additional commandment, thou shalt keep thy religion to thyself. Thank you, thank you. Seems to me, that only a really low IQ population could have taken this beautiful continent, this magnificent American landscape that we inherited. Well, actually, we stole it from the Mexicans and the Indians, but hey, it was nice when we stole it. It looked pretty good. It was pristine. Paradise. Have you seen it lately? Have you taken a good look at it lately? It's fucking embarrassing. Only a nation of unenlightened half-wits could have taken this beautiful place and turned it into what it is today, a shopping mall. A big fucking shopping mall. You know that? That's all you got. That's all you've got here, folks. Mile after mile of mall after mall. Many, many malls. Major malls and mini malls. They put the mini malls in between the major malls. And in between the mini malls, they put the mini marts. And in between the mini marts, you got the car lots, gas stations, muffler shops, laundromats, cheap hotels, fast food joints, strip clubs, and dirty bookstores. America the Beautiful. One big transcontinental commercial cesspool. And how do the people feel about all this? How do the people feel about living in a coast-to-coast shopping mall? Well, they think it's just fucking dandy. They think it is cool as can be because Americans love the mall. They love the mall. That's where they get to satisfy their two most prominent addictions at the same time, shopping and eating. Millions of semi-conscious Americans day after day shuffling through the malls, shopping and eating, especially eating. Americans love to eat. They are fatally attracted to the slow death of fast food. Hot dogs, corn dogs, triple bacon, cheeseburgers, deep fried butter dipped in pork fat and cheese whiz, mayonnaise soaked, barbecued mozzarella, patty melts. Americans will eat anything, anything, anything. If you were selling sauteed raccoons' assholes on a stick, Americans would buy them and eat them, especially if you dipped them in butter and put a little salsa on them. This country is big time, pig time. Forget the bald eagle. You know what the national emblem of this country ought to be? A big bowl of macaroni and cheese. A big bowl, because everything in this country is king size. King size, extra large, and super jumbo, especially the fucking people. Apparently in this country, the stupids are an extended family. And besides wearing them t-shirts, everyone in the family's got on a backpack. They got a backpack strapped to their back so they can carry around lots of stupid shit. And the reason they gotta carry their stupid shit strapped to their backs is because their hands must remain free at all times to hold food. And to get that food up to the mouth where it gets shoveled in with all the rest of the disgusting shit they ate that day. And another reason for the backpacks is these people are gonna buy even more stupid shit. They ain't got enough stupid shit at home. They just had a stupid shit sale. They ain't gonna buy more. They're gonna go out in the parking lot and stuff this stuff into the big, fat, ugly, oversized SUV that's got plenty of room in it. Plenty of room in it for stupid shit and lots of room left over for these big, fat, ugly motherfuckers to get them home. Stopping, of course, for jelly roll and fried dough. These people are efficient, professional, compulsive consumers. They think of that as their national pride. It's their civic duty, consumption. It's the new national pastime. Fuck baseball, it's consumption. The only true, lasting American value that's left, buying things. Buying things. People spending money they don't have on things they don't need. Money they don't have on things they don't need so they can max out their credit cards and spend the rest of their lives paying 18% interest on something that costs $12.50. And they didn't like it when they got it home anyway. Not too bright, folks. You know, whenever you're exposed to advertising in this country, you realize all over again that America's leading industry is still the manufacture, distribution, packaging, and marketing of bullshit. High-quality bullshit. World-class designer bullshit, to be sure. Hospital-tested, clinically proven bullshit. But bullshit nonetheless. And it always amuses me that so many people seem to think that bullshit only comes from certain sources. You know, advertising, politicians, salesmen. Not true. Bullshit is everywhere. Bullshit is rampant. Parents are full of shit. Teachers are full of shit. Clergymen are full of shit. Law enforcement people are full of shit. The entire country is completely full of shit. In fact, this country was founded by a group of slave owners who told us that all men are created equal. That is what's known as being stunningly, stunningly full of shit. And you know, I think... And I think people show their ignorance when they say they want politicians to be honest. What are these people talking about? If honesty were suddenly introduced into politics, it would throw everything off. The whole system would collapse. And I think deep down the American people know that. The American people like their bullshit out front, where they can get a good strong whiff of it. It's like the business world. All businessmen are completely full of shit. And then, when it comes to dealing with customers, that's when you get the big smile. That's when you get the big smile. Businessman always has that big smile on his face as he carefully positions himself directly behind the customer and unzips his pants and services the account. We specialize in customer service. You heard that? Now you know what it means. Whoever coined the phrase, let the buyer beware, was probably bleeding from the asshole. Then you have advertising. Advertising is the businessman's cheaply dressed $2 blowjob. Advertising sells you things you don't need and can't afford that are overpriced and don't work. And they do it by exploiting your fears and insecurities. And if you don't have any, they'll be glad to give you a few by showing you a nice picture of a woman with big tits. That's the essence of advertising. Big tits. Threateningly big tits. And speaking of big tits, what about show business? Show business, completely dishonest, corrupt, and full of shit. But in a nice way. Plenty of expensive drugs and perverted sex. If you're gonna be full of shit, might as well enjoy your work. Then you have the media. Not just the news media, let's include them all. The media are almost literally exploding with bullshit. Because they're located right at the crossroads of all the other bullshit. The media are made up of equal parts advertising, politics, business, public relations, and show business. These people are sitting right at bullshit junction. Little bullshit hunt. Gotta look at some advertising lingo, especially food advertising. You know the people. Fresh, natural, hearty, old-fashioned, homemade goodness in a can. That kind of stuff. So let's take a look. Let's take a look at some of these words. Old-fashioned. When you hear old-fashioned, you're supposed to think, oh, this goes back to the old days. Right. The old days. Before we had sanitation laws. Before hygiene became popular. Back when botulism was still considered a sauce. Then you have homemade. Homemade. You see this on the packages in the supermarkets. Folks, believe me, it is physically impossible for a food processing plant to produce anything homemade. I don't care if the CEO is living in the basement and cooking on a hot plate. It's not gonna happen. And you shouldn't be eating processed foods and packaged foods anyway. They're no good for you. You know how I stopped eating processed foods? I started picturing the people who were doing the processing. Next time you're in the bus and you see some guy with gangrene on his hands, just picture him on the assembly line putting little pieces of chicken in a box. That'll cure you. Then go home and eat some fucking grapes. At any time they add the word style to another word, someone is pulling your prick. Old style goodness. What does that mean? Nothing. It means nothing. New York style deli. It means it's not located in New York. That's all it means, or they wouldn't have to say it in the first place. It's located in Calgary, and the owner is from Hong Kong. And the food tastes like things that the Bangladeshis throw away. Chicago style pizza means the night manager once changed planes at O'Hare. Family-style restaurant. You know what that means? It means there's an argument going on at every table, two people are crying, and the eldest male is punching the women. Family-style. Family-style. Then you have gourmet. Here's another word the advertising cretins have completely wiped their asses with. Gourmet. Gourmet dining in a cup. Gourmet cuisine in a can. By the way, whenever you hear cuisine in place of food, be prepared to pay an extra 80%. Gourmet rolls, gourmet coffee, gourmet pizza. These things do not exist. You want to know a gourmet food? Toasted snail penises. Candied moose balls. Deep dish yak dick. Gourmet. Here's another full of shit food word. Hearty. Hearty. Soup is hearty. Breakfast is hearty. You know what I do when I hear the word hearty? I look at the label. 300 grams of saturated fat. Hearty, as in heart attack. It's the same with buttery and lemony and chocolatey. Real chocolatey goodness. You know what that means? No fucking chocolate. Beware when they add the word flavored to another word. Lemon flavored drink. No fucking lemons. As a pet food now refers to itself as a chicken flavored treat. Wait, chicken flavored treat? Right. No fucking chicken. And zesty and tangy. Zesty and tangy are not real words that normal human beings use in conversation. They're advertising words. Do you ever have someone turn to you and say, this is real zesty and tangy too? Natural. This is directed to all you health food fiends and environmental nitwits and yuppie cocksuckers who are running around in your natural fibers. Your natural fibers. The word natural is completely meaningless. A chemical company's toxic waste is completely natural. Dog shit is natural. You wouldn't know it from some of the things I've said over the years, but I like people. I do. I like people, but I like them in short bursts. I don't like people for extended periods of time. I'm all right with them for a little while, but once you get up past around minute and a half, I gotta get the fuck out of there. And my reason for this, my reason is for one that you may share, possibly.
I have a very low tolerance level for stupid bullshit. That's all. Stupid bullshit. You know? And everyone wants to tell you their stupid bullshit. And a lot of them don't know when to stop talking. You ever run into that guy? Doesn't know when to stop talking, just continues running at the mouth like verbal diarrhea. Don't know when the conversation's over. Stupid, trivial shit you don't care anything about. Things you're not even remotely interested in. Looking through your mind for something diplomatic and tactful and graceful that you can say to help end the conversation. And all I can ever come up with is, blow it out your ass! Blow it out your ass! Blow it out your ass! But you can't say that. You, good manners don't permit it. You have to find another way. And I go to body language. I try to use my body language to show that the conversation's over. I find myself leaning at a 45 degree angle, trying to indicate the direction I'd like to go if this person would just shut the fuck up. And that I might even give him a verbal cue. Surgery. Surgery. I'm late for surgery. I'm having my ears sewn shut. You know? Yeah. Same people on the phone. Same people on the phone. Don't know when to hang up. Don't know when the conversation's over. Dumb, trivial shit. Dumb questions. So what are you guys going to do 5 summers from now? We haven't made any plans. Marge wants to go to the beach. The kids kind of like it at the lake, and I want to go to the mountains. Grandma wants to visit her sister in Frog Balls, Arkansas. How about you? Have you made any plans? It's never too early to make plans. We're going to Norway in 2025. Did you know that up until the 1950s, Norway's economy was based largely on fishing? But now, thanks to the expansion of the world economy and increased, improved drilling technique, and once again, you're searching through your mind for the right thing to say to help end the conversation. Shut the fuck up comes to mind. Or blow it out your, how about shut your fucking pie hole might be good. Or if he prefers cake, shut your fucking cake hole. But these things, you don't want to, you can't say those things. And you can't use body language on the phone. Well, you can always amuse yourself, you know. But that doesn't move the conversation along. You have to find another trick. And I go to tone of voice. Do you ever use your tone of voice to try to talk them into a soft landing? You try to coax the person toward the end. Right. Good. Okay. Good. All right, then. Good. Right. Okay. Good. Okay. Okay. All right. Oh, fuck. There he goes again. That guy's again. You remember my neighbor with the burns on 90% of her body? Well, she burned the other 10% now. She was lighting a fart and her bush caught fire. Listen, listen, Reverend. Reverend, I hate to be rude, but I just took a 3.5 hour shit. And I'm bleeding from the asshole. Well, I don't have any Mercurochrome. Yes, I'll put a Snoopy Band-Aid on it. Thank you. Yeah, thank you. You do that for me. Yes, say a prayer for my asshole. Thank you very much. You have to resort to these tactics because many people do not understand what a phone call should be or what a phone call is. Ideally, a phone call is the brief exchange of a few vital pieces of information. This is a phone call. Hey, Steve, what time's the Circle Jerk start tonight? 10 o'clock. Okay, listen, I'm going to be a little bit late. You'll have to start without me. That's a phone call. It should not be a 2.5 hour harangue of your third cousin describing her mailman's liposuction. God, people are fucking boring. People are just fucking boring. You know what would be great for a guy like me? Just to be in a coma. Huh? Wouldn't that be great? Nothing to do all day. You just crap out and breathe through a fucking tube. They feed you through a tube. There's nothing to do. Well, you talk about being a couch potato, that's it, man. No phone calls coming in, nobody dropping by unexpectedly. And if they do drop by, you're completely unaware of it. Because you're in a fucking coma. And you're practically clinically dead. And you don't have to listen to their stupid shit. Their stupid shit, like about their new ride around lawnmower with the two-tone horn and the GPS in case they get lost on the lawn. And their boss and their job and their car and their kids. Jesus fucking Christ. Their kids. Let me tell you something, folks. Nobody cares about your children, okay? That's why they're your children. So you can care about them and we don't have to bother. But they want to show you the pictures. Sometimes they warn you, you know, that's good. They say, hey, you want to see some pictures of my kid? No. Just describe them to me. But they show you, and there are two ways you can handle it. I have found two ways to handle the pictures. The first is the easy way. You just kind of take it all in stride, matter-of-factly, go along with the game. Ooh, boy. Ooh. Girl. Yeah. Older boy. Older girl. Good. Four. Listen, I have to go wash my crotch. I'll see you later. And you get the fuck out of there. Or you can do what I do. You can do what I do. Be a little honest about what you see. Take a chance. Tell the truth. Look at the fucking head on that kid. Have you put him on YouTube yet? Hey, let me ask you a practical question. Where do you find hats for a kid like that? Tell the truth. Don't be bullshitting people. Don't be bullshitting. There's enough bullshit as it is, folks. Just plenty of bullshit. Then they want to show you the pictures of the little girl whose second teeth are coming in. Once again, tell the truth. You better start saving your money right now, pal. It's going to cost you a fucking fortune to fix that. You're going to need an international team of orthodontists around the clock. Listen, why don't you just have them all pulled and let her start over again, you know?
How do we come up with this shit in this country? Where do we get our values from? Bulimia, there's another winner. Real all-American disease. This has got to be the only country in the world that could ever have come up with bulimia. Got to be the only country where some people are digging in the dumpster for a peach pit, other people eat a nice meal and puke it up intentionally. Where's the morality in that? I don't understand our values. By the way, speaking of American values, aren't we about due to start bombing some small country that only has a marginally effective air force? Seems to me like we're a couple of weeks overdue to drop high explosives on helpless civilians. People who have no argument with us whatsoever. I think we ought to be out there doing what we do best, gang, making big holes in other people's countries. I hate to be repetitious, but God, we are a warlike lot, you know? We can't stand not to be fucking with somebody. We couldn't wait for that Cold War to be over, could we? Just couldn't wait for that Cold War to be over so we could go and play with our toys in the sand. Go play with our toys in the sand. And while we're not invading some sovereign nation or setting it on fire from the air, which is more fun, then we're usually declaring war on something here at home. Did you ever notice that? We love to do that, don't we? We'd love to declare war on things here in America. Anything we don't like about ourselves, we have to declare war on it. Don't do anything about it. We just declare war on it. We got a war. It's the only metaphor we have in our public discourse for solving a problem. It's called declaring a war. We got a war on poverty, the war on crime, war on litter, the war on cancer, the war on drugs. But you ever notice there's no war on homelessness, is there? Nah, no war on homelessness. You know why? There's no money in that problem. There's no money in that problem. Nobody stands. It's true. Nobody stands to get rich off of that problem. You could find a solution to homelessness where the corporate swine and the politicians could steal a couple of million dollars each. You'd see the streets of America begin to clear up pretty goddamn quick. I'll guarantee you that. I will guarantee you that. Now, so, I got an idea for homelessness. You know what they ought to do? Give the homeless their own magazine. Give them their own magazine. It would make them feel better, for one thing. That's a sure sign of making it in this country. Every group in this country that makes it and arrives at a certain level has its own magazine. You have Working Mother magazine, Black Entrepreneur magazine, Hispanic Business magazine. In fact, any activity engaged in by more than four people in this country has got a fucking magazine devoted to it. Give them. Give the homeless their own magazine. You know what you call it? Better Crates and Cartons. Then when they get finished reading it, they can use it to line their clothing. That's a good sound business solution. That's the kind of answer you get from a conservative American businessman. Yeah, let them read it. When they get finished reading, they can use it to plug up the holes and them piano crates they all seem to like to live in. A good sound, practical, conservative American business solution. I'll tell you what they ought to do about homelessness. First thing, change the name of it. Change the name of the condition. It's not homelessness, it's houselessness. It's houses these people need. A home is an abstract idea. A home is a setting, it's a state of mind. These people need houses, physical, tangible structures. But where are you gonna put them? Where are you gonna build them? Nobody wants you to build low-cost housing near their house. People don't want it near them. We got something in this country, you've heard of it, it's called NIMBY, N-I-M-B-Y. Not in my backyard. People don't want any kind of social help located anywhere near them. You try to open up a halfway house. Try to open up a rehab center for drugs or alcohol. Try to build a little home for some retarded people who want to work their way into the community. People say, not in my backyard. People don't want anything near them, especially if it might help somebody else. Part of the great American spirit of generosity we're always told about. Big, generous American nation. Ask an Indian about that. Ask an Indian how generous this country is. If you can find one, you gotta locate the Indian first. We've made him just a little difficult. Right? People don't want anything near them. Except military bases. They don't mind that, do they? No, they like that. Give them an army base. Makes them happy. Why? Jobs. Jobs. Self-interest. Even if the base is loaded with nuclear weapons, they don't give a fuck. They say, well, I'll take a little radiation if I can get a job. Working people have been fucked over so long in this country, those are the kind of decisions they're left to make. I got just the place for low-cost housing. I have solved this problem. I know where we can build housing for the homeless. Golf courses. Perfect. Golf courses. Just what we need. Plenty of good land in nice neighborhoods. Land that is currently being wasted on a meaningless, mindless activity engaged in primarily by white, well-to-do male businessmen who use the game to get together to make deals to carve this country up a little finer among themselves. I am getting tired, really tired. Speaks of arrogance. Think of how big a golf course is. The ball is that fucking big. What do these pinheaded pricks need with all that land? There are over 17,000 golf courses in America. They average over 150 acres apiece. That's over 3 million acres. That's 4,820 square miles. You could build two Rhode Islands and a Delaware for the homeless on the land currently devoted to this meaningless, mindless, arrogant, elitist, racist. Racist. There's another thing. The only blacks you'll find in country clubs are carrying trays and a boring game. For boring people. Did you ever watch golf on television? It's like watching flies fuck.
The thing about this country is, they talk about how we have freedom of choice. Uh-huh. You know, we have freedom of choice. Yeah, very limited. If it's an important thing, limited choice. Two political parties, essentially, two. Big media companies, five, mm-hmm. six.
Max.
Yeah. Oil companies, down to three now, I think, uh-huh. overall, three or four. Banks, the big brokerage houses, the big accounting firms, all of the things that are important reduced in choice. Mm. Newspapers in a city, how many? Used to be 3-4, now it's 1 or 2 that are owned by the same people, and they also own a radio station right. and a TV station. But jelly beans, 32 yeah. flavors, yeah. ice cream, all the things that don't matter. The unimportant things, a lot of choices. Yeah. And you know what I say? You know what your freedom of choice is in America? Paper or plastic.
Yeah.
That's it, man. It comes down to paper or plastic, cash or charge, aisle or window, smoking or non-smoking,
yeah.
Coke or Pepsi. These are your choices. Everything else is kind of laid out for you. You get to do what they really want. They do what they want. The
yeah.
ones who own this country, they do what they want.
Speaking about choices being usurped or taken away from us, what do you make of Well, and I'm fascinated to ask you this because all the things that you've been talking about for years are, I mean, we've come full circle on this stuff. And that's why I was so fascinated, and thank you for coming on the program.
Sure.
But here we are now, you know, 30 years after you were talking about it, with this huge debate, this huge fight about whether or not our civil liberties are being taken away from us. What are your thoughts on...
Well, I think if you looked at the record of laws which have been passed in the last 30 to 40 years, there's a thing called social hysteria. Mm-hmm. Social hysteria is whipped up generally by the media. Crime, in Nixon's time, crime was the big social hysteria issue. Well, there's too much crime, the courts are coddling the criminals, we have to tougher laws. So a lot of civil liberties went away in terms of the rights of criminals and the rights of the accused and the people going on trial. These were limited, they were cut down. These rights which are guaranteed by the Constitution in the Bill of Rights. Another social hysteria, drugs. The drug thing happened, same thing. Big flow of drugs, we're going to fight the drugs, we need newer, tougher laws, we need draconian sentences, we need to be able to go into houses, we need to be able to do this, we have reasonable, you know. All of these shortcuts have resulted in less liberties because of social hysteria. The media whips up the frenzy, people get all excited, the legislature passes it, the president, the executive signs it, and the judges then, the judicial branch okays it sometime later when it gets to them. Mm-hmm. And what has happened is you have less freedom, less liberties, less civil liberties, less rights. And the third social hysteria is terrorism. That was whipped up. Now, it's a little probably a little more cause there. You look at the 9/11, it's a very dramatic event. Mm-hmm. But that, too, has been used with this Patriot Act to reduce our liberties. They say, well, if you have nothing to hide, what are you worried about? You know that old argument? Oh, yeah, good. Yeah. You ask, tell me about the people that are, you know, just getting out of prison because of the DNA, if they had nothing to hide. It's just, listen, this country is owned by the ownership class. They do pretty much what they want. I figure it's like a freak show. Here's what I do. You know what I do? To me, if you're born in the world, you get a ticket to the freak show. They get a ticket to the freak show. If you're born in America, you got a front row seat.
See, I'm not one of these people who's worried about everything. You got people like this around you. Country's full of them now. People walking around all day long, every minute of the day, worried about everything. Worried about the air, worried about the water, worried about the soil. Worried about insecticides, pesticides, food additives, carcinogens. Worried about radon gas, worried about asbestos. Worried about saving endangered species. Let me tell you about endangered species, all right? Saving endangered species is just one more arrogant attempt by humans to control nature. It's arrogant meddling. It's what got us in trouble in the first place. Doesn't anybody understand that? Interfering with nature. Over 90% of all the species that have ever lived on this planet, ever lived, are gone. They're extinct. We didn't kill them all. They just disappeared. That's what nature does. They disappear these days at the rate of 25 a day. And I mean regardless of our behavior. Irrespective of how we act on this planet, 25 species that were here today will be gone tomorrow. Let them go gracefully. Leave nature alone. Haven't we done enough? We're so self-important. So self-important. Everybody's going to save something now. Save the trees, save the bees, save the whales, save those snails. And the greatest arrogance of all, save the planet. What? Are these fucking people kidding me? Save the planet? We don't even know how to take care of ourselves yet. We haven't learned how to care for one another. We're going to save the fucking planet? I'm getting tired of that shit. Tired of that shit. Tired. I'm tired of fucking Earth Day. I'm tired of these self-righteous environmentalists, these white bourgeois liberals who think the only thing wrong with this country is there aren't enough bicycle paths. People trying to make the world safe for their Volvos. Besides, environmentalists don't give a shit about the planet. They don't care about the planet. Not in the abstract, they don't. Not in the abstract, they don't. You know what they're interested in? A clean place to live. Their own habitat. They're worried that someday in the future they might be personally inconvenienced. Narrow, unenlightened self-interest doesn't impress me. Besides, there is nothing wrong with the planet. Nothing wrong with the planet. The planet is fine. The people are fucked. Difference.
difference. The planet is fine. Compared to the people, the planet is doing great. It's been here 4.5 billion years. Do you ever think about the arithmetic? Planet has been here 4.5 billion years. We've been here, what, 100,000? Maybe 200,000? And we've only been engaged in heavy industry for a little over 200 years. 200 years versus 4.5 billion. And we have the conceit to think that somehow we're a threat? That somehow we're going to put in jeopardy this beautiful little blue-green ball that's just a-floating around the sun? The planet has been through a lot worse than us. Been through all kinds of things worse than us. Been through earthquakes, volcanoes, plate tectonics, continental drift, solar flares, sunspots, magnetic storms, the magnetic reversal of the poles, hundreds of thousands of years of bombardment by comets and asteroids and meteors, worldwide floods, tidal waves, worldwide fires, erosion, cosmic rays, recurring ice ages, and we think some plastic bags and some aluminum cans are going to make a difference? The planet isn't going anywhere. We are. We're going away. Pack your shit, folks. We're going away. And we won't leave much of a trace either. Thank God for that. Maybe a little styrofoam. Maybe. Little styrofoam. Planet will be here and we'll be long gone. Just another failed mutation. Just another closed-end biological mistake. An evolutionary cul-de-sac. The planet will shake us off like a bad case of fleas. A surface nuisance. You want to know how the planet's doing? Ask those people at Pompeii who are frozen into position from volcanic ash. How the planet's doing. Want to know if the planet's all right? Ask those people in Mexico City or Armenia or 100 other places buried under thousands of tons of earthquake rubble if they feel like a threat to the planet this week. How about those people in Kilauea, Hawaii, who build their homes right next to an active volcano and then wonder why they have lava in the living room? The planet will be here for a long, long, long time after we're gone, and it will heal itself, it will cleanse itself, because that's what it does. It's a self-correcting system. The air and the water will recover, the earth will be renewed, and if it's true that plastic is not degradable, well, the planet will simply incorporate plastic into a new paradigm, the earth plus plastic. The earth doesn't share our prejudice towards plastic. Plastic came out of the earth. The earth probably sees plastic as just another one of its children. Could be the only reason the Earth allowed us to be spawned from it in the first place. It wanted plastic for itself. Didn't know how to make it. Needed us. Could be the answer to our age-old philosophical question, why are we here?
Plastic. Assholes.
So, the plastic is here. Our job is done. We can be phased out now. And I think that's really started already, don't you? I mean, to be fair, the planet probably sees us as a mild threat, something to be dealt with. And I'm sure the planet will defend itself in the manner of a large organism, like a beehive or an ant colony can muster a defense. I'm sure the planet will think of something. What would you do if you were the planet trying to defend against this pesky, troublesome species? Let's see. What might... Viruses. Viruses might be good. They seem vulnerable to viruses. And viruses are tricky, always mutating and forming new strains whenever a vaccine is developed. Perhaps this first virus could be one that compromises the immune system of these creatures. Perhaps a human immunodeficiency virus, making them vulnerable to all sorts of other diseases and infections that might come along. And maybe it could be spread sexually, making them a little reluctant to engage in the act of reproduction. Well, that's a poetic note. And it's a start. And I can dream, can't I? See, I don't worry about the little things. Bees, trees, whales, snails. I think we're part of a greater wisdom than we will ever understand. A higher order. Call it what you want. You know what I call it? The big electron. The big electron. Whoa. 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 It doesn't punish. It doesn't reward. It doesn't judge at all. It just is. And so are we. For a little while. Thanks for being here with me for a little while tonight.
But now that I'm an old fuck, I'm beginning to notice some advantages to putting on a few extra years. The first one is, you never have to carry anything heavy ever again. Everybody wants to help an old fuck. If you got a big suitcase or something like that, you know, you just kind of go like this a little bit. You say, yeah, could you help me with this? And yeah, hey, how far are you going? Indianapolis. He wants to help. Fuck him, put him to work. Take advantage of people. Another nice thing about getting old is you can leave any social event early just by saying you're tired. Works great with family members. Just turn to the person next to you and say, geez, I'm getting tired, you know? Oh, you're tired? Come on, Grandpa's tired. Grandpa's going to bed. Someone else says, but it's 7:30 in the morning. There's always one asshole in the family. But the best thing about getting old is you're not responsible for remembering things anymore. Even important things. But it was your daughter's funeral. I forgot. You can even make believe you have Alzheimer's disease. That's a lot of fun. You look around the dining room table and you say, who are you people and where's my horse? Then you stare at your eldest son and say, Agnes, I haven't seen you since First Communion. Fucks them up. Fucks them up. They don't know how to handle it. Takes them a week to get over that shit. And they start listening to you a lot more carefully from then on. So don't be afraid to get old. It's a great time of life. You get to take advantage of people, and you're not responsible for anything. You can even shit in your pants. They expect it. I haven't tried that yet, but I don't rule it out. I'm keeping my options open. Everything is on the table. As the following conversation is bound to take place, probably more than once. Two guys meet on the street. Hey, did you hear? Phil Davis died. Phil Davis? I just saw him yesterday. Yeah. Didn't help. He died anyway. Apparently, the simple act of your seeing him did not slow his cancer down. In fact, it may have made it more aggressive. You know, you could be responsible for Phil's death. How do you live with yourself? Here's another thing they say after a death. This is usually said to the surviving spouse. Listen, if there's anything I can do, anything at all, please don't hesitate to ask. What are you going to do, a resurrection? This ain't the fucking New Testament, you know. You know what you tell a guy like that who wants to help? Oh, fine, why don't you come over this weekend? You can paint the garage. Bring your plunger. The upstairs toilet overflowed and there's shit all over the floor up there. Do you drive a tractor? Good, that'll come in handy. The North 40 needs a lot of attention. Don't hesitate to ask. The nerve of these pricks. Here's another thing we say to the surviving spouse. I'm keeping him in my thoughts. Where? Where exactly in your thoughts does he fit? In between my ass hurts from this chair and let's fuck the waitress? We use a lot of euphemisms when we talk about death, you know? People say things like, you know, I lost my father. Ah, he'll turn up. There's something else that is said after a death, but this one involves belief, which is where I begin to have big problems. This one happens after the funeral, after the burial, back at the house. Back at the house where the family and friends and the loved ones of the deceased are having some food and drink, and they're enjoying some warm reminiscences of the person who passed away. Sooner or later, someone is bound to say the following, especially after a few drinks. You know, I think he's up there now, smiling down at us. And I think he's pleased. Now, first of all, there is no up there. It's poetic, it's quaint, and I guess for superstitious people it provides a little comfort, but it doesn't exist. But if it did, and if someone did somehow survive death in a non-physical form, I personally think he'd be far too busy with other celestial activities than to be standing around paradise, smiling down. On live, people. What kind of a fucking eternity is that? And why is it no one ever says, I think he's down there now, smiling up at us? Apparently, it never occurs to people that their loved ones might be in hell.